Anas Fiwe. And the Lord is blessing us. If you're going through a hard time, if you have experienced challenges this week, I want to tell you today that we serve a God of victory. I want to tell you this morning that we serve a God who opens doors. And there is nothing that is impossible with him. And so as we begin to hear the word of God, I want your hearts to be lifted up. To know that God is hearing your cry. And for you to know that he is on your side. Hallelujah. Somebody say amen. Amen. For you to know that God is listening and he cares. And for you to know that you can be strengthened in the Lord. And so we come together to worship him and to glorify him and to give thanks to him for what he has already done and what he is going to do in our lives. For those of you who are watching us live on Facebook, most welcome. You are part of this congregation and we love them, isn't it? Can we clap for our people who are in the diaspora or wherever they are? Maybe somebody is watching us and they are on a hospital bed. I want you to be encouraged and to know that God is hearing your prayer today. And he is touching you and blessing you. Today we come to the end of the series, The Power of Generosity. And we are going to look at the last lesson that we learned today, Rewards of Generosity. And as we come to the end of this series, it is my prayer that you have been listening and the word of God has been transforming you. That the attitude of your heart has been changed for the better and you have had an understanding through the help of the Holy Spirit that God expects each one of us to care for one another. And so, generosity is not you being asked to part with everything that you have, but it is an opportunity for you to serve a fellow human being through the rewards or through the resources, through the wealth that God has given to you. Hallelujah. So in the last 3 weeks, we have learned three things. Number one, we learned the joy of generosity. That when we are generous, God gives joy or puts joy in our hearts. Hallelujah. And therefore, we do so willingly, and we do so knowing that it not only brings gladness and joyfulness into the heart of the recipient, but also our hearts become joyful in the Lord. Hallelujah. The second thing we learned is about the power of generosity. And the power of the generosity is because generosity has a way of transforming people, of strengthening people. It has a way of causing people to be empowered. That we give hope to people who perhaps would not have had hope. And so, it is a great lesson to know that when we are generous to people, we actually empower them. And then Bishop Kitoto shared with us about the highest form of sacrifice, because it is not easy to do, or rather to be generous. It is not something that comes naturally. But when we do it because our hearts have been transformed and we have been taught how to be generous to one another, that sacrifice that comes from our hearts and from our attitudes, it pleases God. So today we complete, or we conclude, or we bring this ship to dock in this series with a self-evaluation. And a challenge to each one of us from God on whether we indeed really have received a transformation in our generosity attitude. It will be very sad that after 4 weeks of the Word of God and learning what it is that we would continue with the same way that we were. If you are already generous and practicing, I'm sure that you have learned how to even be more generous, how to be a person that changes and brings change, not only to yourself, but also to others, because you are a different person. We have seen from the scriptures that over and over again, God Himself has called us to be generous to people. Being generous, we have learned, it is not about ourselves, it is about the change that we give to others. It is touching someone else's heart. So there are many things that we can talk about, but my desire is that we are not the same again. Somebody say amen. So I'll touch on three things that I feel I want to bring us as a preamble. I want to bring us into our attention just as a reminder. Firstly, we learned that the start of this transformation, what I am saying, that we cannot be the same again, we are being transformed. We started by learning that when we acknowledge that God owns everything, including our possessions, we are transformed. Hallelujah. Now acknowledge. What does acknowledge mean? Acknowledge means that we have stopped fighting. That we have surrendered. We have acknowledged that it no longer belongs to me. It belongs to Him, though I have it. So acknowledging is important, because until you acknowledge that God owns everything, including what we have, then we shall release. Secondly, we have learned that the start of this transformation is when we see ourselves, we look at ourselves as God's stewards. Steward means a manager. A steward means a caretaker. That we see ourselves as God's stewards, whom God has entrusted with just a portion of His riches. And that relationship between us and God, of how much He can entrust to you, is related to how you manage what He has given to you. So many times we are on our knees and we are asking God for more. And God is asking, could you please, first of all, account what I have already given to you? It may be one, it may be five, it may be 10, but the response of God to you is, what kind of a steward have you been? And thirdly, this transformation starts when we learn that it is a privilege, and we heard this last Sunday, it is a privilege and an honor to take care of God's property and use it in ways that please Him. It is a privilege. It is not obvious. Stop complaining. Praise God. Praise God. So you have been complaining and you want a salary hike, but God wants to know, how have you used what He has entrusted in you? Or to you. It is only a transformed mind. And this is what we are looking for. A transformed mindset. It is only a transformed mind that understands the importance of generosity and the selfishness that we have. We must know and understand that it doesn't pay. Listen to the word of God. Proverbs 11 and verse 24. It says that one man gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. That's from the scriptures. So God is saying, the day you will learn that you are my steward and release everything that I have given to you, that you will have an attitude of open hands, that is the day that you will become rich. And riches do not necessarily translate into how many zeros are in your bank account. It is how rich you are within. Hallelujah. Praise God. And I want it to be very clear to us that when we are talking about generosity, we are not just talking about the material things that God has given to us, but we are talking about every resource that God has given to us. Some of us have been given gifts that are so rare that cannot be found in other people. How do you use those gifts? How do your gifts benefit other people? When we are talking about generosity, we are talking about how do we use the time that God has given to us. Some of us are very selfish with our time. You have no time for any other person. You do not have time to listen. Even right from your home, you do not have time for your spouse. You do not have time for your children. You do not have time for anybody who may want just to come and pick your wisdom. You do not have time because you must go and make more. God is saying, I want to interfere a little bit with your life. So he is not only interested in seeing the stewardship of our money and material possession, but he expects us to be generous in every way, including time and talents. And Jesus Christ is our best example in showing passion and concern for people. Many times Jesus was on a journey, going somewhere, and he would be interrupted. Remember the woman with the issue of blood? And he took notice that someone has touched the hem of his garment, and he asked, who has touched the hem of my garment? Who has drawn power from me? And this was in the midst of a huge crowd that the disciples thought he was joking. Jesus, you can see the crowd that is around you and you ask who has touched you. But you know what? He is concerned of one. Hallelujah. He is concerned of one. And because of his concern, that woman was healed. And so this is where, friends, I want us to go, to be like Jesus. The book of Philippians chapter 2 and verse 5 to 7 says that your attitude should be the same as that of Jesus Christ, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing. Made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness to serve you and me. And we enjoy the gift of salvation because of the servanthood attitude of our Lord. So does God reward generosity? Look with me, the book of Genesis chapter 18, verse 1 to 15. Genesis 18:1-15. The Bible says the Lord appeared to Abraham near the large trees of Mamre. And Abraham was sitting at the entrance to his tent. It was the hottest time of the day. And Abraham looked up and saw three men standing nearby, and he quickly left the entrance to his tent to meet them, and he bowed low to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if you're pleased with me, don't pass me by. Let a little water be brought. All of you can wash your feet and rest under this tree." Verse 5, "Let me get you something to eat and give you strength. Then you can go on your way. I want to do this for you now that you have come to me." "All right," they answered, "go ahead and do it." And so Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah, and he said, "Quick, get about a half bushel of fine flour, mix it and bake some bread." Then he ran to the herd and he picked out a choice tender calf and he gave it to a servant who hurried to prepare it. Then he brought some butter and milk and the calf that had been prepared. He served them to the three men. While they ate, he stood near them under a tree. "Where is your wife?" Verse 9. "Where is your wife, Sarah?" they asked him. "Over there in the tent," he said. Then the Lord said, "You can be sure that I will return to you about this time next year. Your wife Sarah will have a son." And Sarah was listening at the entrance to the tent behind him. Abraham and Sarah were already very old, and Sarah was too old to have a baby. And so she laughed to herself, and she thought, "I am worn out, and my husband is old. Can I really know the joy of having a baby?" Then the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh? Why did she say, 'Will I really have a baby now that I am old? Is anything too hard for me?' I will return to you at the appointed time next year. Sarah will have a son." Sarah was afraid, so she lied and said, "I did not laugh." But the Lord said, "Yes, you did." Praise God. In this scripture, we know that it was God who appeared to Abraham, but he did not know about it. But I want you to understand that the scriptures are very particular to inform us that this was the hottest time of the day. And so it was a disturbance. It was a sacrifice that Abraham would rather had sat under the shade of the tree than be bothered about three men that are standing being scorched in the sun. But when Abraham saw these three men, he saw an opportunity to be generous. And the scriptures are telling us that he woke up from where he was and he went to them and he invited them. And he told them, "Come, I will get you some water that you may wash your feet, and I will get you something to eat." They did not ask for it. But immediately, Abraham saw these three men, he saw an opportunity. And my question to you and me is, how many times does the Lord appear in different ways in our situations when perhaps we would rather remain in our comfort and we don't respond? Abraham was an old man. He didn't need to move. But look at it. He did not call one of his servants, "Go and find out what those guys are doing standing there." Perhaps if it was me and you, we would have called our watchmen. Maybe we would have called security. Go and find out what those men want there, standing at our gate, because we are worthy, because we are afraid that they perhaps could be planning on how they will come and steal from us. But Abraham saw an opportunity to serve somebody. Hallelujah. How many times does the Lord pass by us and we don't notice him? These very men, we see two of them in chapter 19. Again, the nephew of Abraham, Lot, gets across these two men as they were going to destroy the city. But the scriptures here, as we read them, we know that there was a third man. And we can tell by the words that he is speaking, because he spoke and he says, there is nothing that is too difficult for me. It's only the Lord who can say that. Hallelujah. And he says to Sarah, I am going to reward you because of the generosity of your husband. Because your husband responded and brought me in, I am going to reward you. And come this time next year, you will have a son. Hallelujah. The Lord is the door. He is a victorious God. He has the key to open those locked doors. We are meeting a couple here who are advanced in age. They had prayed many times and they had waited, and perhaps they had given up. And though God had called Abraham and had said that you are going to be the father of a nation, maybe it had got to a time where he thought perhaps God has forgotten. How many times have you asked the question, is there a God in heaven? How many times have you asked, is there a God who knows my situation? How many times have you said that I am going to give up on this God? How many times have you said, I will not serve anymore because I serve and he doesn't seem to be remembering me? And those who perhaps who are not even serving as committed as I am, seem to have their way of life easy. How many times has the Lord passed by and you have not noticed that he is there? Because you are frustrated, because you think he does not know you. I want you to know that your name is engraved on the palm of his hand. And he never forgets. But he is asking you, concentrate on what I have asked you to do. And that is, reach out to my people and serve them. And as you do so, as we will see in a little while, you are serving me. You see, God appeared to Abraham. His generosity made him respond without hesitation and asked his wife to prepare a quick meal for the visitors. Abraham went out of his way to offer comfort to strangers that he did not know. He did not do so because he was expecting anything from him. But he was eager to be hospitable to them, as was his custom, as was the trend that he had designed, that I am going to be generous with what God has given to me. I am not going to do this because of what I have received from God, but I am going to do it because I believe in him. He was not only a caring father to his family, but he was a man who was given to hospitality and caring with all the wealth that he had. And we know that he was a wealthy man to the entire community. We see Abraham going personally into his herd, and he selected, the Bible says, a choice tender calf. He did not send a servant. Rest the servant goes and picks the weak one for these strangers. He personally went there so that he makes sure that he picks the choice tender calf to offer to strangers. Abraham did not do this expecting a son. Abraham did this because it was his duty to God to be generous whenever the opportunity arises. Hallelujah. How many times, my friend, have you missed the opportunity? Have I missed the opportunity to minister to God's people, to minister to the Lord himself? How many times? Ask yourself, if you were in the position of Abraham, what would have been your response? Maybe even if you were compelled by something inside you, maybe the most you would have done, you would have asked Sarah, I see some hungry people out there. Did we have some leftovers last night?
Hello?
Kuna ugali ya kulala? I heard in church they announced that we are going for missions and we are going to be seeing children who perhaps are orphaned and they don't have dress. Ziko wapi zile guo hatuvaangi?
Bwana asifiwe. Hallelujah. December is coming and you're going to buy new clothes and off-road the ones that are out of fashion and tattered. I'm speaking to myself and to you. Praise God. What did Abraham do? He looked for the choice and tender calf. What did Abraham do? He responded when he should have been resting. That's why the Bible is clear to tell us at the hottest time of the day. You know, the Lord is going to come to you when you are really in need. And what he is asking you to give away is the only thing that you have. He gave God the best from his heart. And the Lord is speaking to me and you this morning. And he is saying through Revelation 3 and verse 20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. And the Lord is speaking, saying that I want to come in. He is speaking in this scripture to believers, and he may come in any form. He may come through a stranger. He may come through a child who has need. He may come through a need that is in your community or in society. And he is asking, who is going to respond? So this scripture is speaking weighty expectations on you and me. God is asking, how can I fellowship with you? How can we fellowship together? How can we have dinner together? And he's not asking this for a private enjoyment between you and the Lord, or just a social hour for your own pleasure. It is a picture of the Lord using it as an instrument to meet the needs of the people around us. And in so doing, we enter into a fellowship with him. Hallelujah. This is what Christ is asking us. When Christ comes in us, he doesn't come in merely to give us a good time or to just bless us. He doesn't come just to make us have an enjoyable experience. He comes in to speak to you and me, to help him fulfill his long-standing desire to be able to bring peace into the world, to bring salvation into the world. He is a savior who is seeking to save the lost. And he wants to use you, and he wants to use me, praise God. He wants you and me to learn, to show compassion to others, to minister to human needs, wherever they may be. And he is going to use you. He is going to use me. This is what God is calling your generosity. But many of us, God has blessed us, and we have no problem giving money. Maybe pastor is preaching this so that he is expecting money. If it is money you want to go for missions, we will give. But God is asking for your time. God is asking for that neighbor that is next to you. God is asking you to go and speak to him politely instead of complaining that he plays loud music throughout the night. God is asking for that passionate heart that will go and speak to that young man who you keep complaining that he is a drunkard, that he comes 2 a.m. in the morning, and when he comes, they make noise until in the morning. They cannot let you enjoy sleep. And God is asking, would you sacrifice some of your time and go and perhaps teach them something new in a lovely way without complaining and writing to Nema? How will you respond? How will you respond? Some interesting scripture in the book of Matthew, chapter 25, from verse 31 to 43. And he says that he will divide the nations into two groups. And all of them claim to be his. But you know what? God sees the human heart. And he says that there are two divisions of people. And he says to one group in verse 41, depart from me, you cast into the eternal fire. And they are amazed and say, why do you say that to us, Lord? And he says, for I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me. Then to the other group, he will say in verse 34, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. And they too will be surprised and say to the Lord, Lord, what do you mean? And he responds and says, for I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. My question this morning, which group will you find yourself in? Which group of people will you belong to? Because the Lord says in verse 39 that when we, they asked, and when did we see you sick or in prison and visited you? And his word is true, which he tells us to remember. He says, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of my brethren, you did it to me. Now you have the answer. Let's wake up, friends, and respond to the word of God. Let's know that he is speaking to you and me. He is not waiting for a group of people that will come. It is you and me who are hearing this word today. And this is the test of our faith. James says, religion that is pure and undefiled before God and the Father is this: to visit the orphans and the widows. Right in their affliction and to keep oneself unstained from the world. James 1, 2, 7. James 1, 27. That's what true religion is. It is not how many times you come to church on Sunday. It is not the fact that you have been commissioned as a member. It is not because you are baptized and your children have been dedicated. God is saying, I'm looking for one who is going to serve me through serving my people. I put a phrase together for myself, and if you like, I would want to encourage you to join me. And I say, what I have today belongs to another. I am only a steward. Would you agree with me? If you agree with me, let's say it together. What I have today belongs to another. I'm only a steward. Do you know what you have just done? You have just surrendered everything that you have. Hallelujah. Oh yes, it is a commitment that you have given to the Lord. And you know what he is going to do? He is going to ask for it. He is going to come and say, oh, you said that everything you have belongs to another. Would you give an hour to somebody who wants to listen to you? I know you had an appointment and you are going somewhere. Would you please make a phone call and tell those people you're going to be late a little bit, because there is someone who needs prayer. Hallelujah. Because there is someone whose marriage is breaking and they need a word of encouragement. Because there is a neighbor's child who needs to be rushed to hospital. And you are the only person who has a car in that neighborhood. Hallelujah. He is going to come to you when you will need to sacrifice something. Because what you have belongs to another. It doesn't belong to you. And let me tell you, friends, when you respond and you will give it out like Abraham did, he will remember that you don't have a son. And he will say to you, this time next year, I am coming and you are going to be holding a son. Hallelujah. Bwana asifiwe sana. He is going to remember that job application that you made. He is going to remember that you are single and you have been trusting God for a wife or for a husband. Praise God. It is in his service that he will meet you. It is in the service, it is in the generosity of Abraham that he found for himself a son. You don't look like you believe me. Somebody say amen. Amen. Because God is asking, who is going to be in the service of my kingdom? Who is it? Who is going to welcome the stranger? Who is it who is going to go into his hand and choose the choice and the tender calf and serve it? And as you do, he remembers you. His reward comes to you. Praise God. Quit complaining. Quit complaining about your unanswered prayers. Be generous with what God has already given to you. Hallelujah. Appreciate what already he has put into your hands. And as you do that, God remembers you. This can only come through love. And God wants us to love people. In the book of Romans 12 and verse 9 to 13, he says love must be sincere. Some of us, we extend love because of the expectations that we have. But he says in this scripture, hate what is evil and cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor. serving the Lord and be joyful in hope. Be patient in affliction, be faithful in prayer. Then he concludes the scripture and he says, share with God's people who are in need. Hallelujah. In the midst of your prayer, in the midst of your affliction, in the midst of your hope, share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Isn't it amazing that God has put that scripture in the middle of a needful person, because it's only him who provides. Sincere love requires our effort. We must go beyond the politeness and the pretense. It involves helping others to become better people. It demands of our time and our money and our personal involvement. You know, sometimes we only give honor with ulterior motive. We give honor to our bosses because we know that they hold the key of a pay rise. Yes, we will give honor to them because we know that through them we can be promoted. But God is saying no. He's saying don't show favor to the wealthy because you are expecting that if I show them concern when they are in need, when I am in need, they will come through. And I know that they are wealthy. God says, love people sincerely. And you know what, how we love people? We only love them for one reason, that they are created in the image of God. No other qualification. Hallelujah. Somebody say amen. Somebody say, I will love people. I'll quickly give you 5 rewards of generosity. Number 1, the suffering of the saints will be diminished, or at least they will be relieved of their suffering. When we are generous, you notice it has nothing to do with your benefit. It has all to do with God's people. You know, when we are generous to people, you help lift up a burden from someone. You contribute to the relief of the stress they are going through. You contribute into creating hope in them. And that is a reward to you. Number 2, the glory of God is displayed through our generosity. The Bible says in Matthew 5:14-16, that you are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light up a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on the stand and gives light to everyone in the house. And the Bible says in the same way, let your light shine before me, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Through your generosity, in giving, in opening your homes, it brings the glory and the goodness and the worthiness of God to be seen by others in your life. Hallelujah. So it brings glory to God. Number 3, generosity brings more thanksgiving to God. It unleashes more thanksgiving to God. So generosity is not only meeting people's needs, but it is also a tool of overflowing many thanks to God. Listen to 2 Corinthians 9:12. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of God's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Hallelujah. So our generosity and our hospitality make and cause people to be thankful to God. And that pleases God. And when God is grateful, what does he do? He remembers you do not have a son. And he says, this time next year, you will hold a son in your hands. Hallelujah. Number 4, our love for God and his love for us is confirmed through our generosity. 1 John 3, 17 to 18. If anyone has material possessions and sees his brother in need and has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with action and in truth. So when we give generously, the love of God is confirmed in our lives. And people know that we do not do it because it is easy. And people know. No, they know that you give because you are a believer and you know that it has been confirmed to you through the love of God. And finally, when we give, we lay up for ourselves treasures in heaven. Luke 12, 33 to 34. This is a hard one. It says, sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourself that will not wear out. A treasure in heaven that will not be exhausted. Where no thief comes and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart is also. So what do we take home throughout this series? What is the attitude of your heart? What have you learned throughout this month? How has it changed you? Generosity, an open heart, is close to the center of our life in Christ Jesus. And the reasons why we don't open our checkbooks and the reason why we don't open our homes to the needy as often as we should is rooted in two things. Number one, fear that if we give, we may not have. That means we don't trust in God. And number two is greed, because we want to hold it and we want to be seeing that we have. I give you a remedy. And the remedy is the pleasure of Christ's presence in our lives. Hallelujah. And when Christ is present in our lives, there is nothing that we need that he will not provide. It is the certainty of Christ's promise to us. When he says that he is going to provide all that we need. Paul spoke to the Philippians regarding the gifts of offering that they had given to him. And he said it was a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice pleasing to God. And he made this promise which I make to you today. I declare to you today that my God will meet all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. I want to say it again. This is a declaration to you from the word of God, Philippians 4:19. And my God will meet all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. Amen. And when we have that and we believe, the door of generosity opens for us. And we give freely because we are not afraid. Because we know that God will open his doors of heaven to us. Hallelujah. May God bless you. May the Lord remember you. May the Lord give you a transformed heart. May God give you a new understanding and a new attitude. May God use you and me to meet the needs of thousands of people that he is going to bring our way. May God appear to you this time, next year. Hallelujah. And you will be holding your son. By that I mean you will be, your prayer will be answered. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. May the Lord God Almighty be praised. Amen. Oh yes, praise God. Amen.